have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 11, and we're going to begin reading in verse 23. Hebrews chapter 11, beginning in verse 23. The Bible says, "By faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw that he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest they should be destroyed, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as on dry land, which the Egyptians assayed to do were drowned." Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. We thank you for your strength, Lord. We pray that you would show up this morning in power and that you convict sinners of their situation before you. Lord, we pray that you would encourage the believer that stands before us, Lord, and understand and know what power there is in your salvation. Lord, how strong you really are. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, I'll be preaching this morning on the thought, religious but not saved. Religious but not saved. Now, in this text that many refer to as the Great Faith Chapter, we find a great deal of people that I think ultimately they were all saved, but they weren't saved through every event that's described here. And I also want you to see, as they're redeemed, their faith grows. Now, I want you to think about it, and really, our faith today is very poor and very low and very anemic. When we say anemic in nursing, we're talking about that there's not enough red blood cells to go around. They're anemic. And if you've ever been in that condition, it always impacts your strength and it causes you to fall asleep easily. That's what anemia does in the natural sense. And the only thing you could pray to God this morning is that your faith might grow. Now, in going back to verse 24, the Bible said, 23, excuse me, "By faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents." Now, the reason I want you to see that Moses wasn't saved throughout this is because a 3-month-old child cannot be saved. They don't know the Redeemer. They don't even have enough cognitive understanding to understand who God is. But I want you to see that he inherited a faith from his parents. Well, what preserved him was the faith of his parents. They saw something in Moses that I believe they didn't see in Aaron. They saw something in Moses that they did not see in Miriam. They wanted him preserved, and they hid him all by himself because they had faith. Now, if you have godly parents that are passing faith to you, rejoice in it. If you have godly parents down through the years, it says, this is what the Bible teaches. Rejoice in it. They are passing a faith along. And I believe we live in a day and age today where we don't see that like we should. You may drag your kids to church, but at the home place, that faith is not being integrated in them. And that's the kind of parents that Moses had. Verse 24. Well, let's read the rest of verse 23. "Because they saw that he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment." Now, I want you to see another thing faith always does, and is a barometer, a measure of your faith, if you will. It'll take care of some of your fears. It'll dispel fear, because it says they weren't afraid of the king's commandment. They had enough faith to hide him, and they weren't upset about the results. They knew God would take care of it. You know why God's people don't move today? They lack faith.
Amen.
When God gives them a command, and I fully believe this, God hasn't quit commanding people to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't believe He's quit, because I'll tell you what, I believe that when the last elect is saved, we're out of here. And so He's still calling. What we have is a bunch of hard-headed young men that don't intend to be obedient. And if you'll follow the life of Moses, and we will this morning, he was that brand. But his faith changed that thing. His faith grew. And ultimately, we need to be like Moses. Ultimately, Moses' faith consumed his whole life. What better testimony could there be? And so it was an inherited faith. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Now, let me interject here. I do not believe he was saved when this happened. I believe he knew about religion. He knew about the God of Moses, but I don't believe he was redeemed. I don't think he got that to an 80-year-old man on the backside of the desert. But I do want you to see his faith was growing. His faith was building. His faith was going along, and you'll have experiences throughout your life that will build your faith. Now, what I found in the modern-day Christian is life occurrences that come along, stress wipes many of them out. Instead of growing their faith, it breaks them down. Instead of encouraging them and make them strong in the Lord, it crushes them. And that ought not to be so among God's people. And many times, I believe, really, what you find in that situation is they were never redeemed to start with. And the crushing that comes along is exactly what proves who they were. Now notice this. Choosing rather to suffer the affliction with the people of God than enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Now if you mark in your Bible, mark this out. There are pleasures in a sin. There are pleasures in sin. But it's a very short season. Now, I would not be a good pastor or a faithful preacher if I told you that sin hurt right now. Because you know what? Many times it doesn't. But you amplify it by about 30 or 40 years, and you'll find out what it does. Now, and I'll just use this as an example. And I've never seen such a time in the hospital. I have found time and time again people 10 years younger than me, in their late 30s, totally crippled by diseases that used to be for old people, such as COPD, such as alcoholism. 38-year-old man I saw last week that was in his last days from having alcoholic liver. A 38-year-old man. You know, I bet when he started drinking as a 15-year-old boy, it felt good. I bet he was tip-top in his class, and everybody thought he was cool. But the thing is now that he's yellow as a pumpkin, and his belly's all out here, not too cool anymore, is he? But there was pleasure in it for a season. I'm sure he was the top dog for many years. But we see in that we don't need to ignore that we, in warning of sin, tell them it doesn't always feel great. Verse 26, esteeming rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Now, I want to interject this. I fully believe this is when he got back. This is when he came home. This was after the 40 years on the backside of the desert, because before that, he wasn't persecuted. Before that, he wasn't hindered. Before he killed that Egyptian man, he really didn't suffer nothing. So, I want you to understand that sometimes your faith, when it's visible, is going to put you in some difficult situations.
Amen.
Your faith, when it's visible, when you look different and act different and present differently than most, you're going to have situations like Moses had. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, but he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Now, if you don't get nothing else out of 27, you see that his faith is growing, and his faith was growing, and he said, I trust the invisible so much that I'll lead 4.5 million out. One man. See, it didn't start out with leading out 4.5 million people, did it? Started very, very minutely. Mom and Daddy hiding for a few days. We need to understand our faith ought to grow.
Amen.
Now, if you're sitting here, you've been serving the Lord 20, 30, 40 years, and your faith has not changed, my advice to you is make your calling and election sure, or either you're lost, or you don't really believe He's able. You know what faith is? Believing God is able to do what He said He would do.
Amen.
That's faith. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have that, you know, faith is an outgrowth of redemption. Faith is an outgrowth from being born again. And that's what we need to look among God's people. Verse 28, his faith grows again. Through faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of the blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. Now, can you imagine how simple of a task that it would seem? And he, you know what? When he said, I'm coming over to take out the firstborn, you know what? He believed God would do it. And you don't find nothing about a death angel. Don't you get that mess in there. He said God did it. He said God took the firstborn. Right? And could you imagine how simple of a task that the very life of your firstborn son hung on dabbing a little blood here and there? You know what can make you trust that? Faith. You know what? I bet when he was painting on, he thought everything's going to be all right. And you know what? I believe there were probably some stupid enough, even within the nation of Israel, that didn't paint. And you know what? I believe if that was the case, they died with the rest of them. Watch your faith. Put confidence in the Lord. Trust Him fully. And we know the Egyptians got no warning at all. And they all suffered the death of the firstborn. Why? Because they had no faith. Verse 29. By faith they passed through the Red Sea by dry land, with the Egyptians assaying to do so, to do, were drowned. Now I want you to get that. And you think after such a victorious event, when they came down to the Red Sea, that they would be rejoicing, that they would be happy, that they would be glad. But what we found, they began to murmur and complain against Moses and against Aaron. And oh, what? You brought us out here to die. And then Moses lifted up his hands, and the Red Sea parted. And you know what it took for 4.5 million people? It took faith to walk out there. Now maybe I'm stupid, and maybe it's just because I have swam all my life. But I wouldn't have too much fear of doing it, I don't think. Only problem is when the sea falls on you, are you going to be able to hold your breath up long enough to get to the top? But my wife was very fearful of water. When we married, she said, Donna, I said, Donna, I'm going to teach you how to swim. And she said, well, Daddy couldn't do it. And I said, well, I can. Well, after about 8 hours, I was like, well, Daddy was right. I can't teach you either. And she still can't swim. You know, she'd be a little more fearful than me, would she not? Can you imagine two huge walls of water and your responsibility was to walk through the middle? You know what made you take that first step? It was faith. It was faith. You know why they were kicking up sand on their way over? It's because it was faith. And you couldn't imagine what they must have saw. And I don't know what it was all involved, but do you think maybe they even looked over to the side and saw fish swimming in there and octopus or whatever? And they were beside them and they were going across. You know what kept the waters back? The mighty hand of God. And you know what kept them moving on forward was their faith. It'd be a fearful thing to run through that place, and you couldn't do it at all except in having faith in the God that's able. Now go with me back to Exodus chapter 2, and we're going to notice some events that grew Moses' faith, and I hope would grow your faith as well. Exodus chapter 2, in the very first verse. And there was there went a man of the house of Levi and took a wife to the daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bare a son. And when she saw him, that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months. Now, I don't know the dynamics, and we never really see the full understanding of who this family was. Because you know what? Miriam and Aaron were older. And it says here that he took a wife, or he got married, and he had Moses. And it may not be, but it kind of looks like to me this wasn't the first wife. He said he took a wife and he had her, but they had two older children too. And if they were recording the marriage in order, maybe they didn't have the same mom. I don't know. But I do know this, that they had enough faith that they hid the child. And all of you mothers that have babies, How are you going to hide that squalling baby when it's screaming at the top of its lungs? By faith, you can do it. By faith, you are able. Verse 3, and when she could not longer hide him, she took him an ark of bulrushes and daubed it with slime and with pitch and put the child therein, and laid it in the flags by the riverbanks. By the riverbank. Now I want you to see this child. And again, you have to understand, Miriam was significantly older because she was there watching him. And she was there. And she's the one, listen, let me go get a Hebrew woman for you to nurse this baby up. So she was older. I don't know how much older, but she was older. And I want you to see, you know what? You take about a three-month-old baby, and you're going to take a basket and make the basket where it can float, and put your baby in it and swish it out into the Nile River. You going to be able to do that? You know how you can? By faith. You know what? I think she fully expected God to do a great thing. You know what's in the Nile River? Crocodiles. But she had full faith that when she pushed that basket away, that God was going to display himself. And you know what? He did. He did. And I don't know that any of us would have faith to put our children in what we would perceive as jeopardy and push him out in the Nile River and say, to God be the glory. But she did. And his sister, meaning Miriam, stood afar off to the wit what should be done to him, or to watch it. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along by the river's side. And when they saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the babe wept. And she had compassion on him, and said, this is one of the Hebrews' children. Now, I want you to get the full gist of this, because God intervened in a great way. Now, if this princess had listened to Daddy, or had took in daddy's approach to the slaves, what would she have done? She'd drown that baby right there. Because remember, that's how they were drowning, and they were throwing him into the Nile River. But see, God moved on her heart because he's mighty and he's able, and he made what should have been an enemy into a friend. That's what faith does.
Yeah.
But that's what faith can move people to do. And we find that the Lord even went further in verse 7. Then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." And the maid went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, "Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages." And the woman took the child and nursed it. Now, what a wonderful provision. Not only did she preserve Moses' life, not only did he preserve Moses' life, but he paid the mama to take care of what she would have done anyway. That's what our God, you know what, that builds your faith. You know, I don't know what his mother's name was, but I bet she went home rejoicing. And you know what she could have done with that other little bit of salary she was getting? She could feed Mary and Sarah too. Because see, we know she at least had two others to feed, right?
Right.
In a desperate time, in a time when people were dying and they were hated of Pharaoh, they were financed by the very people that should have hated them. That's what faith does. Verse 10, and the child grew, and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son, and she called his name Moses, and said, "Because I drew him out of water." And that's what Moses means, to be caught, to be removed. And he was going to remove some things by the hand of God. And it came to pass in those days when Moses was grown, and again, I want you to see, it says nothing about him being as a Jew yet. And it came to pass in those days when Moses was grown, that he went out unto his brethren and looked on their burdens, and he spied an Egyptian smiting an Hebrew, one of his brethren. And he looked this way and that way, and when he saw there was no man, he slew the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. Now, I'm not saying murderers aren't saved, but I will say this, I think by the word of God that Moses was not yet saved. He had a murderous heart, and he also was sneaky. Listen, you watch sneaky people. He did like this and did like this and drove her home. And you know, this is what I found after 25 years in the ministry. Lost people act like lost people. And saved people act like the saved most of the time. Right? And so we see then that he takes this man's life. He takes him out of the way. He kills him. And notice what it says. And when he went out the second day, behold, two men of the Hebrews struck together. So now it's a fight between Jew and Jew. And he said unto him, that did the wrong, "Wherefore smitest thy fellow?" And he said, "Who made thee a prince and a judge over us?" Again, showing he was not yet integrated into the Jewish culture. "And intendest thou to kill me as thou killedest the Egyptian?" And Moses feared and said, "Surely this thing is known." Now, I want you to see that when you think nobody's watching, somebody is. When you think nobody has seen it, and you've got away with it, somebody is watching. He did his quick over the shoulder, but he missed somebody, didn't he? Somebody saw him either kill the Egyptian, or saw him burn him or something, because somebody knew. Listen, people, your sin will find you out, what the Bible says. It'll come home to you. It won't be pleasant when it comes home to you. But it definitely and for surely, that sin will eventually catch up with you. Verse 16 or verse 15. Now when Pharaoh heard this thing, he sought to slay Moses, but Moses fled from the face of Pharaoh and dwelt in the land of Midian, and he sat there by a well. Now let me interject this in verse 15. Listen, Pharaoh was looking to get him out of the way anyway. Soon as he had somewhat of a just reason, Pharaoh was ready to take Moses out. And the reason why, really, Moses could have been in line for the throne. Moses could have been in line to be the very king of all the known world at that time. And this other Pharaoh wanted to take him out of the way. And so, as soon as he had opportunity that was semi-just in the eyes of the law, he was ready to do it. Now, verse 16, so he fled down to Midian. Now, the priest of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came and drew water and filled the troughs to their water with their father, and filled the troughs to water with their father's, to water their father's flocks. Excuse me. Now, don't get the idea that the prince of Midian was a believer, because he wasn't. He was an idolater. That's why I say again, I don't think Moses yet was a saved individual, because he was willing to intermarry with these people. The Midianites were very much people who were idolaters. It was kind of an intermeshing of Islam and Judaism, or the Jewish culture. And the prince of Midian was really somewhat of what we would think today is an Islam. And he married their daughter. And the shepherds came and drove them away, but Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock. And when they came to Reuel, their father, he said, "How is it that you're come so soon to the day?" And they said, An Egyptian delivered us out of the hand of the shepherds. So what did Moses look like and present like? Like an Egyptian. They said, "There's an Egyptian down there, and he helped us out." So that comes to me, this: how do you present? You know how they picked him out as an Egyptian? He looked and dressed just like an Egyptian. Now, I don't know much about the Egyptian culture. Adam probably could tell you more. But to me, it always looks like the men are wearing a pleated white skirt. And then they don't have nothing on from here up. And then some kind of weirdo head thing up here. You know, that's how they picked him out. And you know what? That's how the world's going to pick you out too. That's how you're going to look. That's how you're going to present to the world. And so they said, "This Egyptian man helped us out." And he said unto his daughters, and "Where is he? Why is it that you have left this man? Call him that he may eat bread." And Moses was content to dwell with the man. And he gave Moses Zipporah his wife. I mean, his daughter. Now, listen. If you're content in a place, you like it there. If you're content in a place, you fit in. If you're content in a place, you have no problem with what they're up to. That's why I say Moses wasn't saved. But I will say this, God preserved him all along the way, didn't he? You know what gave me breath of life and food to eat before the Lord saved me? Grace. That's what it was. And that's the kind of grace that Moses was benefiting from. That was the type of grace that Moses understood up to now. And it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of bondage, and they cried, and their cry came up upon God by reason of bondage. Now I want you to see, listen, things can always get worse. We think we have it bad now. You listen to me. Things can get worse. You think you're having a hard time with enough food on the table now. Things can get worse.
Amen. Yeah.
Man, when you know, it was pretty bad that he felt it necessary to kill a man. They were being treated so bad. But now things are worse still. And you think all through the plagues that was brought by the hand of God through Moses, and every time the Pharaoh made things worse. Don't think that you're at the pit bottom yet. Because what I found, when you think you're at the pit bottom, you'll go a little bit deeper. Now, I also want you to see the unlikely person that God uses to lead out 4.5 million people. You know what? In my own mind, I was the most unlikely candidate to be a preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ that I could think of. I couldn't imagine why He would use me for such an esteemed office as pastor of the Lord's churches. Is one of them. And you know what? I fully believe this. That whenever God chose him, he was still lost as a goose in a hailstorm. But he says, that's the one I'll use right over there. In fact, he knew it before the world began. He knew who the deliverer would be. He knew the one that he would use to fulfill his plan for this people. Verse 24, and when God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob, and God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them. The first verse of chapter 3. Now, Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. Now, I want you to see that still we see no indication whatsoever that Moses is saved. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. Now, let me say this. As far as a brush fire, it was an everyday thing. They's on the backside of the desert, so hot there that the fire could ignite on its own. So it wasn't an unusual thing to see a forest fire. I'm sure he was wanting to keep his sheep out of the way of it. But he looked down there, and the unusual thing was this. It was just burning and burning, and the bush was still there. See, something unusual will catch your attention. Something unusual will cause you to pull to the side. That's the miraculous hand of God. He does that, and he really gets our attention. And he goes down there, you know the rest of it. And he says, Moses, take your shoes off. You're standing on the holy ground. You've arrived. You're now mine. And he says, who art thou, Lord? Just like Paul said it. And he said, I am the great God. And then he said, I'm going to give you a job to do, and your job is to go down there and lead those 4.5 million people to their own land, and I want you to defy Pharaoh. That's what happens in chapter 4. And just like any other lily-livered Baptist, he said, I can't do it. And you know what? He couldn't in and of his own right. He wasn't able. He didn't have the ability. And I'll say this, he did not yet have enough faith. You may say, Brother Larry, why am I going through this? Why is it so difficult right now? Well, my answer to you is you don't have enough faith. You've got to learn from it. Faith is built like one stone upon the other throughout the entirety of your life. You have to move along. You have to learn a lesson. And if you're hard-headed like me, you have to learn the lesson again. And you know what I found with that second schoolmaster? It ain't as nice as the first one.
Right. Amen, bro.
So you better get your lesson in while it's there and study it real hard so you don't have to go through it a second. And so we see that this man, Moses, was introduced to God And he knew the great I Am for the very first time. That's when he was saved. Now, what we see throughout all his life from this day forward, he always wanted to know more. He always wanted a closer walk with the Lord. You know what is an earmark of a redeemed person? Is they want a closer walk with the Lord. And if they're satisfied, I worry about it. Not all songs are scriptural, but I love that song. When I'm in the presence of the Lord, I'll be satisfied. And we shouldn't get satisfied before then. It shouldn't become routine. It shouldn't be say, well, this is good enough. I'm going to abide here for a while. It should always be that our desire would be nearer and nearer and nearer to the Lord. We find the plagues in Exodus chapter 5 to chapter 12, and I will interject this. A lot of people think he went right down there and said, let my people go. But read your Bibles, and he was down there 3 years before he ever approached the throne. And you know what was happening in those 3 years? He was building his faith. I'll even go further. God was building his faith. See, because they said, who are you? Notice the reaction of the children of God always to God's manner. Like, what do you mean, leave? You talk about leaving, they're going to make it worse on you. And so he had to gain their confidence. And 3 years, he began to understand and know God even more than he did on the backside of the desert. And then we know the plagues come. And I want you to go to Exodus chapter 14. And I refer to this, but I want to read it in your hearing. Exodus chapter 14, verse 29. But the children of Israel walked upon dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. And the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw that the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw the great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptian. And the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Now you see an event like that, it'll cause you to believe. You know what? When you see miraculous things begin to happen, it strengthens your faith. You say, well, Brother Larry, we live in a day and age where a Red Sea crossing don't happen. Well, my question to you is why? Yeah. I'll tell you why it won't happen, because we don't have enough faith. You know what? When we see the Lord begin to work with our little church in order to bring us, it will thrill our hearts. We see young men called to preach the glorious gospel of Christ. We order stand and give him praise and honor. Because see, that is the moving of God. We belittle seemingly the acts of God today, but I want you to see when they were delivered, they rejoiced greatly. Look with me in Exodus chapter 33 this time. And you know all that he went through with that rebellious people that constantly asking, saying, my belly is empty, I'm thirsty, why'd you bring us out here to die? And again, you know what? Well, you know how stupid Moses must have felt when he said, Moses, I know you're thirsting to death, and I know the 4.5 million is thirsting to death, so here's my plan. You take that little rod, and you slap on the rock, and the river of life's going to flow out. Could you imagine looking at 4.5 million of hungry, thirsty people, and that'd be God's plan? You know why he's able there and go get you a little tap? He had faith. He had faith. And you know what? He gave you a little tap and said the water gushed out. And you know, I've heard some people say, oh, it was a big mountainside. Well, the only problem is that the Bible doesn't say that it is. Right. You know what? It could be as small as one of those little limestone pebbles we have on that parking lot. And God could issue water for years out of one little pebble. You know why? Because of God. Amen. And it really had nothing to do with the rock.
No.
It had what it had to do was with Moses' faith. And so we see then that again and again that God puts Moses in situations to grow his faith. Exodus 34 and verse 29. The Bible says, "And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of testimony in Moses' hand, and when he came down from the mount, that Moses was not, that the skin of his face shone while he talked with them." Now, did you get that? Spending a little time with God impacted what? His flesh. Isn't that a wonderful thought? You know how he took up the shine of God? The Shekinah glory is what the Bible calls it. It's because he spent time alone with God. You know how you want to be more like God, act more like God, have the faith that comes with it? You spend time alone with God. You spend a time alone reading and studying the book, and you spend time alone praying. Notice every time that God met with him in a strong way, he was by himself. You think that's coincidence? You think that's just happenstance? No. And listen, mamas and daddies, I understand your plate's full. You know, if you have to use your time while you're driving to work, or ladies, if you have to use up your time while you're trying to get a bath, you use it for God. You use that time because you're going to have the best enjoyment and the best results of prayer when you are alone with God. And that's what he did. Now go with me to Exodus chapter 32, and we're fixing to be done. Exodus 32. He says in verse 26, "And Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said," who's on the Lord's side? "Let him come unto me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together unto him. And he said unto them, Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, Put every fourth man his sword by his side, and go in and out from the gate to the gate throughout all the camp, and slay every man his brother, and every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. And the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and there fell of the people that day about 3,000 men." Now see, what you have to do is have faith that God will do great things. Moses was just an ordinary man with an unusual plan from God. And every day, brick by brick, time by time, God grew Moses' faith. Until at the end, he says, "Moses, you come with me. I'm going to let you look over into the promised land, but you're not going to get to go there. But you're going to look over and see it." And in fact, the Bible says, "Moses, today you're going to die." What about if you got that news today? Now, we believe it from the doctor, don't we? So why don't we believe it from God? "You're going to die. It's all over." And he said, "This is what I want you to do. Go up to Horeb, the very place he started, and look over and see the promised land." And you know what the Bible says? It said that he climbed the mountain. He wasn't feeble and fixing to die like we think of it. He walked up that mountain at 120 years old, better than I climbed that mountain by your house. And when he got up there, he looked over. The Bible says, then he died. See, faith will take you to the very end. Didn't say that he was mournful. Didn't say he was fearful. Didn't say he was twisting his hands. Said he went up there and climbed the mountain by himself. Got up to the top, and it was over with. So what kind of faith do you have? Do you have faith that the Lord is going to use you throughout your life? Do you have faith when death is near that you're going to have a peace like that Moses had? Do you have faith enough if the Lord says you do this to follow through with it? See, you know what hinders us a lot of times from doing what God told us to do is what other people will think. It really is. You know what? You shouldn't worry about what other people think.
Amen.
If God's giving you something to do, just do it. If it's to move on the backside of the desert, or if it's to go down in the streets of Harlem in New York and preach the glorious gospel of Christ, you go. You go. That's where faith begins. Brother Junior.